talking pandemic, medical terms through Greek and Latin. I'm Dunstan Lowe of the University of Kent, and I'm going to be talking today about the importance of a little bit of Greek and Latin for understanding medical terminology. Okay, so why are Greek and Latin useful for medicine in this day and age? Well, most of the words that are used today, including the words medicine, physiology, and so on, are actually from ancient Greek and Latin, ultimately. And even the new words that are made up use the same languages. A lot of universities recognize this around the world and teach their students Greek and Latin strategically as a way to acquire understanding of languages quicker. And this is something that not only medical students, but a lot of people can benefit from. That's why I want to talk about it today. All you need is a few ingredients, a small vocabulary, and you've got enough to understand not only how the words you know work, but also how new words that you haven't yet met should be spelled and how they should work. Some of these words actually take you back into the origins of the medical discipline. The word artery originally meant an air container, aer and terrain. The other meaning of the word for artery in Greek was windpipe. The word vaccine comes from the Latin vacca, meaning cow. The first used vaccine actually involved cowpox, that's why the word means cow. Greek and Latin take you back into the history of medicine, which is a very long one, and today we can see even the most recent terminology using Greek and Latin. So if you look at this passage which describes the situation with COVID-19 symptoms, you'll see that if we just highlight the words that are Greek and Latin in origin, it's all of the big ones. COVID-19 infection may be asymptomatic but may cause septic shock, multiple organ dysfunction syndrome, and hypercytokinemia. So if we take a couple of basic words, we can find that Greek is very handy for distinguishing similar words. So pandemic or epidemic? Well, demos means people, and ik, the ending, the suffix, means relating to. So if you think of democracy, that's the rule of the people, demos. Epi means upon or among. So epidemic means it's present among a certain population. The epicenter is over the top of. An epigram is something written on something else. Pan means all. So pandemic means it's global. So that's the difference between a pandemic and an epidemic. The word coronavirus itself is from Latin. And if you look at the two halves, you've got corona and virus. The ancient Greeks and Romans didn't even have microscopes, so they had no way to understand what a virus was. But when this one was first viewed in modern technology, it was compared to the corona of an eclipse. You can see from the shape of it in a photograph. So the coronavirus, and the word virus itself means something noxious, a noxious substance. So it was understood right away that what was being viewed was connected with disease. Thinkers compared noxious substances to illness-causing agents. Okay, so if we take a difficult word, hypercytokinemia, and break it down, we find that Greek helps us to understand what it means and remember it. So hyper, which is like Latin super, means over or above. Kutos is a cell, kinesis is movement, haima means blood, and then ia, the suffix, means a condition. So we line up these parts together and we can decode it piece by piece. Hyper, hyper. Hyperglycemia is too much sugar, hypoglycemia is not enough. So understanding the prepositions, the words at the beginning, are important. You put all these parts together. Over, cell mover in the blood situation. So the hypercytokinemia is also called a cytokine storm, or an overload of cytokines in the blood. So it's easy to remember what that word means when you recognize what the parts are. And the situation here is, if you know how one word is formed, you can understand how others will be formed before you know them. So sepsis and septic, orthopsis, orthoptic, synthesis, synthetic, pepsis, peptic and peptides, it's to do with digestion, Pepsi was a digestive aid, thorax, thoracic, pelvis and pelvic. These all follow rules for formations of Greek words, making describing words out of thing words, adjectives from nouns. So you don't have to know all of the grammar, but just a few strategic facts can really give you a leg up in learning words to do with medicine. Some other key terms that are topical at the moment because of COVID-19. Diagnosis and prognosis. They're types of gnosis, knowledge. Now, diagnosis means, dia is through, apart, and here, separating apart. So knowing the illness apart from others, if you diagnose something, you've distinguished what that one thing is, separate from other illnesses. and the prognosis is what's going to happen later. So pro is forward, looking forth to the future. What happens going forward is the prognosis. A couple of other terms here. If you see the word nasopharyngeal, you know what the nasum and the pharynx are, then you know where the swab is applied. And then immunotherapy, again, the word breaks down into a Greek and a Latin word. So immunis is Latin for protected. Therapeia is Greek for therapy or treatment. So it's a treatment that defends you. So Greek and Latin can be used systematically. Words are really interesting, and some of them have amazing histories, but the practical use of Greek and Latin for medicine is something you can strategically apply in a very short time. So prefixes is the beginnings of words, suffixes, I've mentioned, is the endings of words. And larger words like hypercytokinemia can be decoded if you take them apart and identify the little pieces, which can then be found in other words. Greek is foundational for medicine in general because the first Western doctors were Greek, and the tradition evolved through the centuries ever since. Latin is central for anatomy because of a much later time when anatomy was became fully scientific in the modern sense, and figures like Vesalius are responsible for that. In the 16th century, Vesalius's On the Fabric of the Human Body, which had a Latin title in the original, was foundational for the discipline of science applied to medicine as it is today. So this refounding of medical studies involved giving labels to a lot of parts that either had casual or multiple names or maybe no name. And as you can see, the bones of the ear, in his description, involve the malleus and the incus. These are simply Latin words for hammer and anvil, because they look like those things. Those have become the standard words. Science itself, knowledge itself, is power, in Francis Bacon's words. So medical students, humanities students, and in fact anybody can benefit from knowing a bit of ancient Greek and Latin when they're thinking about medical language and indeed the body more generally. So ancient languages can teach you about your body, but the body, conversely, the way that it's described and studied, teaches you about ancient languages. So studying a little bit of Greek and Latin in the right way, you can save you a lot of time. If you're interested in ancient studies of or attitudes towards disease, then you might want to look at our other videos about plague in antiquity. You can look at our YouTube channel for that. Indeed, you can follow Kentiquity on social media to find out more about our department and its activities. Thanks very much for your time.